all so much for coming. I know my classmates and I are very appreciative, and I hope you enjoy my project. So a lot of people around my age are starting to think about what they want to do when they're older, what they want their career path to be. And as you can see right here, I got a bit of a jump start on this. And as a lot of you know, I'm a big outdoors guy, and I love doing tons of things outside, skiing, biking, running, you name it. And unfortunately, a lot of those things are at risk right now due to the state of our climate and climate change. And so I knew for my senior project, I wanted to help better the environment. Something else I was becoming increasingly aware of when I was deciding what I wanted to do for my senior project is how privileged I am to live in a safe community with all kinds of caring people, to go home at night, to a warm bed, to a warm meal. I basically have everything I need. And so I really wanted to not only help the world as a whole, but also help an individual or individuals around me and in my greater community that aren't as lucky as me. So as my contribution, I present to you all my senior project, Tiny House, Big Difference. Now, when I first decided I was interested in building a tiny house, I went over to my would-be mentor's house, Michael Scharf, and we discussed primarily the plans. And our first idea was to have basically a square box. It was my idea, I guess. It was literally a square box and a pointy roof, just like, you know, your average cartoon house. And then we came up with a price estimate. And I was very worried about that. I've never been afraid of working hard. I mean, we knew it was going to be all take a lot of work, and we also knew that it would cost about $2,000 to $3,000. So that for me was the scary part. I've never been afraid, as I said, of working hard. You know, I was ready to take on the work part, but I didn't think it was possible to raise that kind of money in basically 2 months. And I told this to my mom, and we had a conversation at Panera down there, and I basically said, I don't think I can raise this kind of money. And she basically said to me, there is more money in the world than people know what to do with. If you are really focused and committed, you will be totally fine. And I thought to myself, she said, it's just money. And I was like, just money? What are you talking about? So many people do all these things that they don't really like to do for money. And I didn't think it was possible. But I trusted her, and I'm so glad I did. As you can see right here, within 3 minutes of my campaign launch, I received my first $15. I was so grateful for all the support that came in, from Ms. Hall emptying her piggy bank for me, to my classmates, to, you know, parents and my mom's class parents in every class, people in other countries. Thank you all so much. And before I knew it was time to start the actual building. So the first step was the floor. Now I made the floor out of 2x6 boards. Those were used as the floor joists. Those are those things right here. And then, so the boards I put together, and they're 16 inches on center apart from each other. Now the reason they're 16 inches apart from each other is to allow, on top of the floor joists, which they're called, goes about a half inch exterior grade plywood. Now the plywood sheet is 4 feet wide. So the 16 inches apart floor joists allows for the two seams of the plywood to meet right above a joist so that they can get nailed in, and the seam stays nice and tight. And then it was time to start the framing. But before we did that, this is where the professional architect side of my mentor comes in handy. And my mentor, Mr. Scharf, proposed a design change which would basically increase the surface area of the face of the house and add lots of glass, which allowed for more natural light to come in and lessen the carbon footprint. And we went over the details of the design, and I realized it made a lot more sense than my original design, and I really liked it, so we decided to pursue that. And I started framing the walls. Shout out to Eddie right there. So as you can see right here, this was one of my first framed walls. I made the walls out of 2x4s, and those are the 2x4s make up the bottom plate right there, the top plate up there, and then the vertical pieces are called studs. Now, as you can see, there's a double stud on either side of the window, and the inside stud, which is that one right there, holds up this piece called the header, which provides structural support over top of the window. And then it was time to actually start raising the walls up. Now this is, I talked about building being very rewarding before. This is the part where it really becomes like cool. Like you're starting to see all this work you put in really become something and grow vertically. So that was a really awesome experience, obviously. Thanks to all the people that helped me out here. And then it was time to do the loft floor. So my tiny house has two floors. And I used 2x6s as well for the floor joists of the loft. And thanks to Grayson for helping me out here. And here I am marking out the floor joists, which are 16 inches on center, just like the bottom floor for the same reason. Now, forget iPhones and cameras. The nail gun is by far the most life-changing technology I've ever used. And it didn't only make my project easier, it made my entire life less stressful. I swear, it was just, thank you so much to Mr. Hinkle and Mr. Macri for lending me two compressors, two nail guns. It really made my life so much better. And then here is the loft floor sheet, and I used an interior grade plywood on the second floor just because that is going to be the actual floor space that's exposed, so it looks a little nicer. And here I am starting on my knee walls, which are the walls up in the loft, as you can imagine, they're about knee height. And these were the first angle cuts I had to make, and I used all my trigonometry I learned in school, so kids, pay attention to math, because you do actually use it in the real world, believe it or not. This is all my math. Now, after I completed the loft and the knee walls, it was time to just complete the front side walls. Now, these side walls are about 14 and a half feet tall. At the top, so I had to buy 16-foot-long 2x4s, which, as you can imagine, wasn't too easy getting home in an SUV, but we managed. We persevered, and one thing I learned early on is that it's very important to double-check everything. At first, I kind of just measured things and trusted my measurements, and that caused me to make many mistakes. And so what I learned early on is that it really takes to build your frame. And don't put a lot of nails in. I didn't even put in the middle piece, as you can see, right here yet. And I just held it up against the side to make sure it fit right before I finalized it and put in more nails. So always double check. Good lesson in life as well. Here I am securing. Here I am securing the side walls again. We had lots of good times. It was rough. There were some long nights, cold days, but we had lots of good times. And I was always accompanied by my one and only scamp and these biodynamic donuts. And then it was time for the front wall. Now the front wall I was really excited to do because that would kind of finalize the frame. Now right here, as you can see, these two spaces right here are for the 3x3 glass windows on the front. And then as you will see shortly, and right here I'm using a technique called toenailing, which is basically where you don't go into the wood like perpendicularly, you go in at an angle, and the nail gun makes this a lot easier. And so here I am, I'm almost done with the rafters, and then it was time for the roof sheathing. So I used a half inch exterior plywood, for the roof sheathing, thanks to Billy. It wasn't easy to get up there. As you can see, we had to be very creative. You see my dad right there. It was a little sketchy sometimes, but we got everything done. At one point, I didn't have a ladder that was tall enough, so I had to make a ladder out of some scraps I had. So yeah, there was a lot of charity. And then the time to insulate the floor. So originally, we had planned on insulating the floor with a spray foam insulation, and we were planning on just kind of reaching under and spraying it in, but eventually it became apparent that this wasn't gonna work due to cost, and we couldn't really find the right materials. And so, thank goodness, I ran into Garrett's dad, Mike Clark, at Lowe's, and he offered to bring his big forklift over that Saturday and help me lift the entire house up to get insulation in under the floor. Now I used a different kind of insulation for the floor than I used for the walls. It's a kind of harder, expanded polyester insulation. And then underneath, I covered the bottom with a half-inch pressure-treated plywood. And it's very important that it's pressure-treated so that it's, since it's close to the ground, it's very susceptible to molding. And the pressure-treated wood is a lot sturdier. and then it was time for the house wrap. So the house wrap is basically a precaution to make sure the insulation doesn't get any moisture in it. Because when that happens, the R value of the insulation is greatly diminished, which basically means how well it protects against temperatures. And then I just cut out all the house wrap on the inside of the windows, stapled it into the inside of the window frame, and hoisted up the windows. Here I am with my dad, hoisting up the bigger windows onto the front, and Billy. Billy's hiding in there. And then it snowed. As many of you guys know, I'm a winter guy. I love to ski, but it kind of put a damper on everything. It made things a lot more difficult. And coincidentally, I was just starting the siding then. Now, the siding is kind of the part where you realize, oh man, like that 90 degree angle turned into an 85 degree angle. And it happens a lot easier than you would think. It's very normal in construction to actually have, not everything's perfect, and I really wasn't aware of this until the siding. And this is where all these sort of blemishes started coming in, and I was getting really worried. And there was kind of this catchphrase I had, like, oh, the trim will cover it, the trim will cover it. And it did eventually. Here's me giving my mentor some building advice down here. And now, above the first layer of siding, it's very important to use this flashing right here. It's called Z flashing, and what that does is prevent moisture or rain from getting in on the inside of the siding, because that can rot it out from the inside. Now, I didn't use conventional siding on this just because it takes longer and it costs more. This, I used something called T111, which works great for all my purposes, and it has a nice natural sort of beadboard look, so I really like that. And then it snowed again, which made everything even more difficult, but at the same time, it was really satisfying to see my house in action, you know? It was like out there, roof was holding everything up great. So yeah. And then came the trim. The trim will cover it, the trim will cover it, the trim covered it. It was so, honestly, that is one of the most satisfying things I have ever done. Just as you can see right here, I used a pine 1x4 trim, and I just covered all the windows around the doors and around the bottom. Now, here I am building a ladder to access the loft, and these doors, which I hung, they weigh about 200 pounds each. They're, I think, about 30-year-old doors, and for something like this, they're solid wood. Actually, a couple thousand dollars for this. For these, at Lowe's today, I paid $300. And I had to hang them myself, which was quite difficult, but it was a really good experience. And you know, as I was doing all this, I kind of realized it's hard in the moment, but these are life skills that are going to become very useful later on. Huge thanks to my electrical guy. I don't know if you guys know Rick Al. He's a local electrician. You might have seen him on campus. He came over. He basically did everything for me. He donated all sorts of materials, and he was just incredible. So thank you so much. Now then came the insulation. So the insulation, I used a standard 2x4 insulation with that was R13, so that's a relatively standard, that's probably what you guys have in your houses, and I just stapled it into to the studs. Now before the insulation, I had never been in trouble with the law before, give or take a few instances, but I was paid a visit I guess pretty late at night by the local police due to noise complaints. So that was interesting. Now here is the finalization of the exterior. Shout out to my mom and sister for painting the doors red. It really brought everything together much better than the dull green, as you can see. Now on the inside, I have already installed a bit and will be installing more beadboard. It's quarter inch wood that looks just like this. It has grooves running down it, and that'll be what the whole interior will be finished with. Now as you can see right here, I can't even begin to describe how grateful I am to everybody for making this possible. On the one hand, this was my senior project, but really, it was everyone's project. If it weren't for the way this community, the people, most of them in this room, came together and made it possible for me to do something like this. As you can see, the second design cost more than $3,000, and I was still able to even surpass my goal. So I thank you guys so much for all your support. These are all the names right here. Not all the names. This is just my GoFundMe supporters, so thank you so, so, so much. Before I end, I'd like to give some thank yous. So first, I'd like to thank Ms. Montiglione and Mr. Davis for helping me with my speech, as well as Ms. Radefeld for always supporting me, being my advisor. I'd like to thank all my friends, each and every one of you guys in my class, being so supportive, being interested in what I was doing. The guys would come over often on the weekends, help me go to Lowe's, help me pick stuff up. Taylor came over. She, you know, was staining away for hours right before our concert. Lucas, my man Lucas right there, he was a huge help. He came over all the time to help with anything I needed. Obviously, again, I'd just like to say thank you to Mike Clark for coming over with his forklift. Super helpful. Rick L for my electrical again, and Mr. Grossenbacher, who is going to be doing my plumbing tomorrow. I know I already thanked my friends, but there were a couple people that really went above and beyond. First of all, Grayson Sussman Squires. I would come in the morning, yo, what do we have to do today? Like, let's do this. You got this. So supportive. And the thing about Grayson, he wasn't just an extra pair of arms, he was an extra brain. He was involved in the planning. He was catching my mistakes. Everything. At one point, he even said, yo, I think I've done more work on your senior project. So thank you so much, Grayson. Billy Chen. There was the classic, you know, I was watching. I'm like, hey, how was your day today? And he'd be on his computer, he's like, you need my help. I do need your help for 5 minutes, I swear. 40 minutes later, 12 o'clock at night, freezing cold, we'd come back in. Thank you so much, Billy. My brother Henry, who is now enjoying his time in Argentina. He spent so much time out there with me, going to Lowe's, you know, carrying things, helping. He was also, like Grayson, involved in the actual planning, helping me out with some of the math, because he was in trigonometry right at the time I was doing all my so, yeah, shout out to the math teachers again. And then Emily, thank you so much as well for spending your time, your precious time, painting my doors. It was so helpful, and also just dealing with all my, I wasn't always the best person to be around during the time of this project, I will admit, but thank you for taking over my chores, walking the dog, doing the chickens, yada yada. Thank you so much, Emily. And then, my lovely mother, I would not have even started this project if it wasn't for my mom. I truly did not think it was possible to raise this kind of money. And she convinced me, and I didn't believe that I could do it, but I trusted her, and I'm so glad I trusted her, because she was right, it was possible. She helped me with the fundraising, but so many other things as well. You know, she's gone out to IKEA, helped me stage it, so thank you so much. Thank you. just like Henry, he was there all the time. He obviously has a very busy job, lots of things he's got to do, and he made my project his priority. He stayed home from work sometimes. He was just there whenever I needed him. I couldn't have done it without him. Thank you so much, Dad. Definitely not least, I'd like to thank my lovely mentor, Mr. Scharf. I can't even begin to describe how much he taught me. The guy taught me how to build a house. So many useful things from him. But interestingly enough, the number one thing I learned from him didn't really have to do with building, because I watched as he lived his, he has a very busy job, two kids, and I watched how, despite all the things going on in his life and how busy he was, he made the time to help me. And I was so amazed to see how he could do that and manage everything. And it's really inspired me in my life. And I know when I'm older and I have the opportunity to help someone with my skills, I'm most definitely going to do that, even if I don't think I have the time, because it's always possible to make the time. That's what you taught me. Thank you so much. Up on stage, Mr. Sharp. I have some trinkets for you, some donuts, a golden hammer. So come on up. We did it. Benefit our community, my original plan was to donate it to a family in Spring Valley. However, that didn't end up working out just because of legal things. So I'm actually looking at an option at the fellowship right now, and it would be in the program that takes care of the elderly and makes sure they have a purpose in life, as well as the farming program. So that's what I think is going to happen to it right now. I think it'll end up in the fellowship.